Okay, lessons in money. We're going through a study here for the Liberty Bible Course, part one, which will finish part one book today. And the study is to be used with the King James Version of the Bible only. Otherwise, your answer is going to be wrong. And we start off, when you can look back in the YouTube videos and sermonette audio, that tithes, offerings, and alms. We looked at before the Old Testament law. We looked at during the Old Testament law. We looked at the church age. We looked at you're to give with a clean heart, a willing heart, not grudging. You know, not holding on to it, you know, and crying over it after you put it in the plate. We looked at taxes. Does the government have a right to charge taxes to its people? Does a Christian have a right to pay taxes to a corrupt government? We looked at Rome. Jesus said, pay your taxes in Rome. And we looked at what Rome did to Jesus. And then look at what Rome under Nero did to Christians. And that Peter and Paul said, you obey the powers that be, you're to pay taxes. Romans chapter 13. We looked at the government stance under God. And we looked at loans, about getting loans. We looked at giving loans out. We looked at you gotta use wisdom. You gotta be sure. Because you know the Bible calls surety. That's a co-signing of a loan. And those studies you can look back and find, as this is part four. Those were parts 1, 2, and 3. Now we're going to get into part 4 in this study, and we're going to look at interest. We did loans, now we're going to do interest. And the first thing what we're going to look at is the definition of interest. According to the Merriam-Webster's 11th Dictionary, interest is a charge for borrowed money. It's a charge for borrowed money. When you borrow money from a bank, you have to pay interest to use that money. Money becomes a product. On a typical house, a loan for 30 years, you could actually pay the bank 3 times the amount of money that you borrowed. So if you got a $100,000 loan, it's a simple number. By the time you're done, you can pay $300,000 in interest. 3 times the amount of money you borrowed, all that extra money is interest. So, another just easy number, you borrow $100 from somebody, and you pay an interest of $50. Well, $100 is what you borrow. $50, you can pay $150. $50 was the interest. More than what you should have paid. Now, the charging of interest. The Bible does allow charging interest to people who are not related to you or who are not saved. Deuteronomy 23:20. Deuteronomy 23:20 There is biblical grounds, and we're going to read them. Now I'm going to give you the book, chapter, and verse number, and you can get them. You can follow along. If you can't keep up, write them down. Check them out later. But this is not what I say. I will tell you if I said it. I will tell you if it's my thinking. I will tell you after that, you can probably throw it in a garbage can. But if it's scripture, if it comes from a King James 1611 Bible, you can follow along and read with me. Now, sometimes I will goof up on the words because I'm a sinner. The Bible is not. It's God's Word. Now, I can understand you can buy a Bible on the market and, you know, they do accidentally change, misspell a word or a word is left out accidentally. Well, you know where I'm coming from, that we're going to check God's word. And Deuteronomy 23:20, it says, unto a stranger, now that's a non-Jew, a heathen, a Gentile, in contents, thou mayest lend upon usury. Usury is using money and being charged to use the money. But unto thy brother, a Jew, of the 12 tribes of Jacob, thou shalt not lend upon usury, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all that thou settest thy hand to do in the land, whether thou goest to possess it. The meaning of the word usury is lending of money with an interest charge for its use. Again, that's the Merriam-Webster 11th Dictionary. So it's not completely wrong to say, hey, I'm going to let you have some money. You're going to pay it back, but you're going to pay me money for using my money. But there are biblical restrictions. The instruction was given to Israel that could lend money to people of other nations and charge them interest, but they could not charge another Jew interest. The Jew referred to each other as brothers, as we read in the scripture, as I said. Now, let's go to Romans 9, 3 and 4, church age book. We went to the law, now we're going to go ask Paul. And some people don't like that. But Paul writes to the Gentiles, he writes to the church age. His books are to the churches. In Romans 9, 3 and 4, for I could wish that myself were accursed for Christ from my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertains the adoption, and the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises. Paul records his thoughts for his fellow Jews. Paul was a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin, and he calls them my brethren in verse 3. So the Bible does not allow charging interest to people who are not related to you or who are not saved. If somebody's in your family and needs money, the Bible says you're not to charge them. If somebody's in the church saved, you're not to charge them. The Bible does allow charging interest to people who are not related to you and who are not saved. I think I made a wrong statement there. Let me say this again. The Bible does allow charging interest to people who are not related to you and who are not saved. You are allowed to charge interest to a lost person. The Jews were not allowed to charge their brethren. And who are not saved. Well, the Jews were God's people. Those who were not Jews and those who were not saved were Gentiles. They were allowed to charge the Gentiles. You are allowed, according to Scripture, to charge anybody who's not related to you and who's not saved. So if your next door neighbor comes over and he's not in your bloodline, and he's not a child of God, you can say, hey, I'll let you borrow the money, but I'm going to charge you interest. That's allowed. I hope I've gotten that straight now. I put my tongue where it shouldn't have been. Number two, the Bible does not allow charging interest to people who are related to you or who are saved. Now note, the Jews are God's chosen people. Always will be and always will be. And always will be, despite what some people teach. But all Jews are not saved. That is a clear by the previous verse and by other passages as well. In Romans 10:1, brethren, my heart's in desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Well, today, not all Jews are saved. There are Jews, even though they are God's chosen people, as an individual, they will die without Christ and they will burn in hell for eternity. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, which is Jesus Christ, and going about to establish their own righteousness, works, the law, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the light, not the law. And there are Jews who will not believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. A Jewish person becomes a child of God like any other person does by faith in Christ Jesus. Now, what does Galatians 3:26 say about this? For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Now, while we're in Romans chapter 10, look at verse number, where is it? Verse number, chapter 10, verse 12. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. If a Jew trusts Christ as a Savior, he's a Christian. If a Gentile trusts Christ as his Savior, he is a Christian. They are Christians. They are brethren now. They are children of God by Jesus Christ. Seeming the Israelites are God's chosen people, and they are, and he did not allow them to charge interest to their brethren, and they weren't allowed to, then we can apply that to Christians as well, because Christians are also brethren to each other. So let me poke a little question here. You're a Gentile, or we're a Gentile. You're saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm going to give you two questions. A fellow Jew who's your brother in Christ, who trusts Christ as a Savior, wants $100. Do you charge him interest? No. Why? Because he's your brother in the Lord. Question number two. Your next door neighbor is a Jew. He's not of your family. He's not saved. He comes over. He wants to borrow $100. Are you allowed to charge him interest for the money? Yes, you are. Why? Because he's not saved and he's not of your family. Matthew 23:8 says, but be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. Family. Now, what about if a family member is lost? He's not in Christ. Is he your family member? Well, yes. Do you charge him interest? No. But I don't trust. Well, we discussed that last week with giving out loans. You wouldn't give him a loan if you didn't trust him. This is not a matter of trust or not, this study. This is, you are going to give somebody a loan, and this is the question by God. Can I charge them for using my money? And the grounds that we saw is no grounds for charging for money if they are a brother in the Lord or sister in the Lord. Or second, they are your own flesh and blood. An aunt, an uncle, sister, definitely a wife or husband, your own children. Who would charge your own children money to use their money? And some of you are probably trying to find a loophole. What about stepchildren? They're a relation? See, always somebody's always trying to look for a loophole. No, a Christian is not a brother to an unsaved, because the unsaved person has a different father. John 8:44 is an unsaved man's father, the devil. Now, some of these verses, for the sake of time, I'm not going to go run to, but some we will do, but we're going to go to John 8. The Gospel of John, chapter 8. You know, money is a wonderful thing, like water. You know, you can have not enough water and die. Or land could be desert. You can have the right amount of water and be healthy and have a developing city. Listen, major cities and towns and population areas are all around water. You're not going to find a city in the middle of a desert somewhere. And then again, you get too much water and you end up with an ocean. Or a lake. And where do you see a city or anything like that in the middle of in the bottom of an ocean or the bottom of a lake? It doesn't happen. And money, you can have too little money where you're not getting by. You're not surviving. And then you can have the right amount of money. Your bills are being paid. You're giving to God. And you're offering to missionaries. And you're helping some people in the church. And you know, you're able to go out to dinner every once in a while, and you have a house that has food in it. And then you can have excessive money where, you know, you got money you're not even using. And the Bible says the love of money, you can love money, is the root to all evil. Money is good, but the love of money is evil. And where you're thinking about loopholes on this lesson about should I charge somebody money because I want money, money, money myself. Well, that's a sin. And God wants you to keep the family relations and the brotherly love among the brethren that you're not going to overcharge them for what their needs are. And we talked about in the last one, part three, if you look at giving the loans out, that's not what we're talking about here. If you're dealing with somebody who's not faithful, or you don't think that the money being borrowed is for a good cause, you look at part three and that lesson here. We're looking at now is you have said, I'm going to give you a loan. I'm going to give it to you. Now the question is, do I charge you for the loan? In John 8:38, we're going to read, I speak that which I have seen with my Father, capital F is God, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father, small f. There's two different fathers when we're talking spiritual. Verse 41. Ye do the deeds of your father. Now watch the F's. Is it an uppercase or is it a lowercase? Uppercase is God the Father of the Bible, our Creator. Lowercase, we're going to see, is not necessarily a human father here, but there's another father. There are three fathers. You know, like a traffic light has three colors. There's a husband, a wife, and a child in a family. There's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There's the Old Testament, the Gospels, and the New Testament. God runs things by threes. You got earth, sea, and air. So let's see the threes here. We've already seen the capital F as in God the Father. We know they have an earthly Father, or they will not be here. But there's another Father, a small f here, that we're looking at, that we're discovering here. And we're trying to figure out now relationship. And what we're looking at as relationship here is a spiritual relationship. And then in verse 41, ye do the deeds of your father, small f. Then say they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one Father, capital F, even God, capital G, which they don't. And Jesus is going to tell them that. Jesus said unto them, if God, big G, were your father, big F. I got that. God is the big F for Father. There's a father with a small f. Let's see who that father is. Verse 44. Ye are of your father. Now, which f is that? That's a small f. Is that the big f of God the Father? No. Ye are of your father, the small f. Now, read with me, the devil. The lust of your father, which f is it? Small f. Who is their father? Satan, the devil, in verse 44. They are not of the capital F Father. Now, when a Christian is born again and God adopts him and he's sealed by the Holy Spirit, his father becomes the big F Father. So the unsaved person, whether Jew or Gentile, has the devil as his father. That means that they cannot be our brother unless they get saved. That's an very important note to be noted. That you can be blood related, family, or you can be related by the Father, capital F. If they're not saved, they're not under your father, but their father. According to the Bible, in Exodus 22:5 and 22:25, Exodus 22:25, if thou lend money to any of my people, if thou lend money to any of my people, God speaking, that is poor by thee, thou shalt not be to him as a usurer, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. And again, that's using money and you charging them. Now, in the Old Testament, they were brethren not by the blood of Jesus Christ, not by Jesus, but they were brethren by the fact that they were of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 tribes. Old Testament. They were circumcised Jews under the covenant of Abraham, under the law of Moses. They were of Abraham's seed, again, through Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 tribes of Israel. In Deuteronomy 23:19, it's recorded, thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother. Usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury. Now look at that verse. Now let me ask you a question. What did the verse say? Usury of money. Okay, that's what we're talking about. You give a guy $100 loan. You are not to charge him interest on that money. The verse says usury of victuals. That's provider. That's food. That's nourishment. If a Jew, we're talking about a Jew here. If a Jewish woman goes over to the house next door and borrows a couple eggs, because she's going to make something for dinner and she don't have the egg, can the woman of the house charge the woman for those two eggs if she has to bring three eggs? No. Can I borrow a cup of sugar? And when you go pay back the sugar, you don't bring a sack of sugar. You bring a cup of sugar. Isn't that interesting? We're not just talking about money, and we're not done here without usury of anything. Well, I'll lend you my truck. Well, they didn't have trucks back then. I'll lend you my ass. Can you charge him interest to use the ass? Now, isn't that a question? Let's bring it up to date today. You're a Christian businessman. You rent out U-Hauls. Christian brother comes up to you. He's going to be moving. You say, okay, I'll let you use the U-Haul. Now, this is not a far away move. I mean, he's moving to the other side of town. In other words, he's going to bring the U-Haul back to your place. Do you charge him for the use of the U-Haul? Well, that's not interesting. Oh, yeah. Okay. But didn't we go back here? Didn't we see, where was it? The meaning of the word usury, the lending of money with the interest charged for its use. Isn't he using the U-Haul? And according to Deuteronomy 23:19, that it can be a victual, you know, borrowing eggs or sugar, or anything that is lent upon usury? But we say it's a rental fee, so we can, you know, go about and it's not interest. It's something being used, something to think about, something to pray about, isn't it? Where is your heart? Is it upon the earth or is it in heaven? That's something to really think about, isn't it? As we go to Leviticus 25, 35 to 37. Leviticus 25, 35. Aren't we supposed to love the brethren? Aren't we supposed to be looking out to help them out? Leviticus 25:35. Leviticus 25:35. In the Scofield Bible, the heading here is the Law of the Land, Part 4, the Poor Brother. And if thy brother, Jew, spiritualize it, Christian. Now we're called brethren. If thy brother be waxen poor and fall in decay with thee. Isn't that the state of America today? Aren't there Christians out there losing their jobs? So we can bring this interest study to today, June 4th, 2013, can't we? This is not no old archaic thing that we can talk about and just say, okay, we're done with the lesson and let's go on to something else. This is something we can apply to today. Then thou shalt relieve him. The government's not in charge of taking care of people. If they're saved born-again Christians, they ought to be helped by other born-again saved Christians. If they're living right, I should say that too. They're not lazy. Though he be a stranger or a sojourner, that he may live with thee. Take thou no usury, the use of money charging of him, or increase. Now look at that. Now look how it's put in an increase. Don't charge them usury and don't get no money for it. So don't change the word. Don't say, here, I'm going to help you out, but I'm going to give you a charge. It's not interest. It's a charge, or it's a fee. I'm going to charge you a fee. And the Bible says no. N-O. Whatever word you give to it. It's like shacking up. No. It's fornication. It's an affair. No. It's an adultery. They're gay. No. Sodomites. Stop giving pretty little names to sin. S-I-N. We're going to read verse 36 again and read with me. Take thou no usury of him or increase, but fear thy God. Oh, look at that. If you have intention to charge your brethren, your family, or a fellow Christian, you don't have the fear of God. You have the love of money. That thy brother may live with... That thy brother may live with thee. Wow, taking the guy into your own home. Thou shalt not give him thy money upon usury. Have you got it clear? Nor lend him thy victuals for increase. And there is that victuals again, food. You don't say, hey, listen, here's a cup of sugar. Now you bring me a sack full of sugar. You don't say, well, I'm going to give you some meals until you get back on your feet. But once you get back on your feet, you're going to give me a free ticket for the rest of my life. You don't do that. This passage in Leviticus 25 that we read, verses 35 to 37, is very interesting in that it talks about not lending to a stranger with interest. When the stranger is your brother. Now, did you get that? Did that raise an eyebrow when it says thy brother, but in the same verse 35 says if he be a stranger? Did that provoke no thought in you? Did you not like, well, that must be a scribal error. What's they talking about? Why did it say that? When the stranger is applied to the brother. Applying that to a Christian, then it would not be right to charge another Christian interest, even if that Christian is a stranger, not related to you, and may not even the same nationality. You say, what's the story? A Christian belongs to a church, born again, saved, picks up his family, is going to move on. Halfway, somewhere between point A and point B where he's going, somewhere between that, his automobile breaks down. He falls upon your church, your family. He ain't got the money to fix the car. He ain't got money to get down to point B. He's a born-again Christian, but yet to you, you don't know who he is. Well, brother, the auto shop says it's going to be $538.25. I ain't got it. You call the pastor of his church, say, oh, wow, he's in trouble and all that. I'll tell you what, we'll send $200. That's what we can send for. If you can give him the $300 and change and all that. But you find out he is truly a dedicated Christian. You give him the $300 and change. Do you have the right to charge him interest? No. Even though you don't know who he is a born-again Christian. And he is your brother in the Lord, even though you never met him. How else can I apply that else? Hi, I'm your Uncle Joe from, and there's my car out there. You know, look at that. I need some money. And I found out, you know, today, you know, Aunt Smith and all that. You know, we're family. And you call a few family members. I mean, listen, find out the credibility. All right, he is your uncle. You never met him. Maybe never even heard his name. He's got a broken car out there or whatever. He wants to borrow money from you, and you find it credible that you will give him the money. Last lesson. Do you charge him interest? No. Why? He's your family. But I didn't know who. He's your family. Please notice that in the passage that we are not only forbidden to charge interest when we loan these people money, but also if we give them food or lodging. Only the actual amount that costs us should be charged to them. Now let's get back to that U-Haul thing. Lending that U-Haul out to that guy, that trailer, it won't cost gas or anything like that. Does that cost you anything? If it doesn't cost you anything, do you have the right to charge him a fee? No. Now, some way the U-Haul company finds out that, you know, you rented it out and you got to pay the company $29, $30, making an even number. For whatever reason, they find out you every time you rent that thing out, if it costs $30. I'm just saying. What do you charge that guy for using your brother in the Lord or your cousin Sally? What do you charge them? You charge them $30. I almost said $39. I don't know where $39 came from. You charge them $30 if it costs you $30. In other words, you don't make a profit on Christians, and you don't make a profit on family. You don't. You do it at cost. If you took a poor brother into your house to stay for you for a while, you could charge him for the food that he ate. You can tally up what he eats. Rice-a-roni, 99 cents, hamburger, whatever it costs for a pound, how much he... You can do that. You can charge him for the food he eats. You can charge him for the phone calls he makes. You can take your phone bill, all right, he made this call, you can add that to the list. For the hot water that he used, you can say, listen, you know what? My electricity since you've been here has been above what we use. The above what you use, you can charge to him. The amount of water that he uses above what you use, you can charge him that. For the increase of the electric bill, as I said, but you cannot make a profit off his stay. If he costs only $20 more to your electric bill, you don't charge him $40 for electric. It's only your actual extra cost. The idea is to spare him extra costs so that he can get out on his own as soon as possible. Now, let's play it down. I'm going to make a trip to Connecticut and in this week into next week. I've got to pay a certain amount of money to the motel we're going to stay. Had we followed scriptures, I should be able to call a born-again Bible-believing Christian and say, listen, we're coming to Connecticut. We'd like to stay in your house, and we'll pay you for food, electricity, and all that. And then we'll pay you for the food. We'll pay you for anything else like that. And I will give you an extra 50 or 100, whatever. But he's not to charge 50 or 100. He's to charge you for cost. And oh, somebody will say, well, and they'll put it down to the very penny for the love of money. There is no way to encourage laziness. A brother taken into your home is to work and not to be lazy and live off of you. The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 3:10, "For even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat." Now, did you get the context of that verse? A lot of people say, well, if you don't work, you shouldn't eat. That's not the context. There's a lot of Christians today who are not working and they're just barely able to eat because there are no jobs. This verse implies that, listen, when we come visiting, when we come to your area, we're going to work for the food. We're going to do things to be staying at your place. You have a missionary or evangelist come to your church. He comes and preaches. He'll go maybe knock on doors with you. Maybe he'll go into street ministry with you. But he will do some things to help the church while he's there. All right, now, part C. The earning of interest. According to Matthew 25:14-30, it is only being a wise steward to use the resources that you have to multiply them. 25:14-30 in Matthew. For it says in verse 27, "Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received my own with usury." The same principle is applied to Luke 19:12-27. And in verse 23, "Wherefore then givest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required my own with usury." The Bible encourages ambition, but never greed. 1 Timothy 6:10. I'm going to have you look these up on your own. But 1 Timothy 6:10. I've been quoting this all night. "For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted," 10th commandment, 9th commandment, "after they have erred," excuse me, "from the faith," they're saved, "and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." Greed causes sorrow. If you have an amount of money that you do not presently need, then it's okay to put it in the bank account and draw interest on it. The Bible says in Luke 19:23, "Wherefore then givest not thou my money into the bank." The bank is making money for themselves by loaning out your money. The least that they ought to do is to reimburse you a little interest money, and as little as what they do for using your money. No, I believe this, and you can throw this in the garbage can, here I go. And these banks are going to stand before God vile. The amount of interest they charge for a loan and how much they give back to you when it's your money is ridiculous. But the problem comes when people have large amounts of money in the bank and do not use it to help their fellow Christians who have a need. In Deuteronomy 15:7-8, "If there be among you a poor man of one of thy brethren within any of thy gates in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not harden thy heart, nor shut thy hand from thy poor brother, but thou shalt open thy hand wide and shalt surely lend him sufficient for his need in that which he wanteth." One reason that people do not lend to their brother in need is because a loan to such a brother would have to be interest-free to be scriptural. I'm not going to give you money because God tells me if I give you money, I can't charge you interest. I'm not going to make no money back. That would mean that they would lose the interest that they were making at the bank. Wow. Now let's say you lend a brother $100. And you got to hire a sheriff or a collector to go get the money. He didn't pay you. And it costs you, with the fees and everything, $50 being you know, round numbers. What do you charge that brother now for that loan? You charge him $150 at cost. It costs you $50 to get the money back, and he borrowed $100. You don't apply no interest or anything. At cost. Remember that. Again, in Matthew 6, 19 to 21. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth or rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break in to steal. Break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. It is not wrong to draw interest on your money. But if you can use it to draw heavenly interest by helping those in need, then do not be foolish enough to lay up earthly treasure. If you charge your fellow brother in the Lord interest, you will lose rewards in heaven because you've already gained earthly rewards. Count it as that. Take the loss of earthly treasures and let God reward you with heavenly treasures. But if you take the earthly treasures in the form of interest, God has no interest in your interest to the Christian, and thus you will not gain at the judgment seat of Christ, or maybe even a blessing that God will give you on this earth, had you already received the blessing. Let God give you interest rather than you taking interest from a brother in the Lord, because God's interest is much more than what you can get. On the other hand, there are times when a relative or another Christian may not be able to get a loan. Because they're unreliable. The Bible tells people to be careful with the money that they're going to lend. It says in Psalms 112, verse 5, a good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Now, what I'm telling you in these two lessons, last week and this week, don't just give out money. So every Tom, Dick, and Harry comes up to you, you don't have to lend money to a family member. You do not have to lend money to a Christian if you don't feel that they're going to pay, if they're going to be reliable. We're talking about in this lesson, if you do trust this person to lend them money, we're talking about you charging. But somebody who is not reliable, you give them money and you don't believe you're going to ever see it again, and it happens, talk to your pastor. I guarantee your pastor is giving money to people and it's bye-bye, never see it again. But oh, I'll pay it back. Do you have the means to help out a brother in a need? Or are you ignoring what you see and what you could do to help? Do not expect people to lend you money. Now, this is the other side of the coin. Do not expect people to lend you money if you carelessly spend what you get. If you're careless with your money, don't be surprised when they tell you, no, I ain't going to give you a loan. Proverbs 3:27-28. Withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of thy hand to do it. Say not unto thy neighbor, go and come again, and tomorrow I will give, when thou hast it by thee. I need $100 and whatever thing. No, I don't have it. And you got in the bank, you got $1,000. Or I need some food. My family and I were going through hard times. No, And you got a refrigerator full, you got your cabinets full, and you got a freezer full. It's there. It's called selfish. It's called not helping. It's called being stingy. Being greedy. Now we close out of part A, part one of Lessons of Money. You go back to the other videos to watch. We'll start book two next week, Lord willing. Or if not, maybe the week after, I'll be out of town. If I remember to bring the book, I'll do it. But you need to watch all four of these videos. You need to write the Liberty Gospel Tracts, 11845 West Carson City Road, 11845 West Carson, C-A-R-S-O-N, City Road, Greenville, G-R-E-E-N-V-I-L-L-E, M-I. I'm not sure where M-I is, which state that is. 48838, you can look them up on the web. LibertyGospelTracts.com is where you can get these books. You do the books, you send them back to them, and they'll grade them. And they'll send it back to you with a completion certificate that you've done them. And there's all kinds, there's all different subjects. These are wonderful books. I highly recommend them. Get them, use them. Become a born-again Christian servant how God wants you to be. Go back and listen to all these. Just don't listen this part and that part. What's your favorite? Listen to them all. And those, the Lord willing, that will come up in the following lessons. May God bless you and your checkbook. And may you find in heaven interest from God for what you do now.